everyone.
Good morning.
Happy Sunday. And happy Father's Day. So very, very happy Father's Day as well. So we want to make sure that we acknowledge and greet our fathers and help celebrate them. So hopefully, fathers out there, you're getting more than just a tie today and more than the gift of you cooking dinner on a barbecue grill. So let's hope for the best for everybody. So let's acknowledge our fathers to start off with. How about if we have any great-great-grandfathers? No great-great? How about great-grandfathers? Ah, the great-grandfathers. Okay, how about grandfathers? Very nice. The hands are going up faster with them. How about fathers? How about stepfathers? Oh, look at that. Stepfathers are very important as well, too. And hopefully I won't get in trouble for asking. And you can feel free, any age that you want to respond to this, soon to be fathers. No, nobody wants to fess up to it. Well, we want to say happy Father's Day to you all and congratulate you for this wonderful day. So thank you so much. We have other things to acknowledge today, too. The beautiful flowers that we have here on the table. These flowers are here today to celebrate Ann and Newt Hagee's 70th wedding anniversary. Aww. So the expiration date has expired. There's no exchanges on either side that can be done. You all are stuck with each other. And these are given in love from Pam and Mike Bradley. So please do make sure that you congratulate them as well today. And then for next week, we do plan on having a Sunday school meeting for anyone who's able to come. We had originally announced that we were going to do it after church, but due to some availability schedule problems, we're going to do it before church. So if you are able to join us next Sunday at 10 a.m., please do so. We'll meet in the ladies' adult Sunday school room, and we'll have a Sunday school meeting to start talking about plans and, you know, what we can do to get started back up. If you can't join, don't worry. We'll share the information with anyone who's interested. All right, how about if we start off with any praises that anyone wants to share?
Yes, Nancy. I praise the Lord for my heavenly Father and for the earthly Father that I had who took great care of my brother and I, was a wonderful husband to my mom, and was my confidence builder.
Oh, wonderful.
He was an absolutely wonderful dad.
Good.
Sounds like a man of God, your father. Wonderful. Anybody else have a praise?
I do have one to share.
Cindy Jones, who is Gloria and Ed Jones's daughter, I believe. No? Who is it? They're a family member. I'll put it that way. A family member of Cindy and of Gloria and Ed Jones's. She's doing much better. She is on our prayer list, but she's going to be coming off because she's been doing much better. So we want to thank God and praise God for the blessings that he's provided to make sure that she's able to come off the prayer list. And if anybody has anybody that's currently on our prayer list that should come up, that's a great thing because that's an answered prayer. So please do let me know and I'll be able to update the prayer list, and then also we'll share the good news as well with the congregation. I do want to have some prayers that we want to make sure that we put in. Jean Pizzetti was hospitalized, and she is in the hospital now. She had a blockage from a hernia and needs to have surgery. So if you could keep both Jean and Dom in prayer. Dom is home resting now from taking her to the hospital early in the morning. And then he's going to go back to the hospital to see her. And then we also want to have prayer for, yes. Keep Teresa in prayer. Asthma may need oxygen, so we'll keep her in prayer. I do have another prayer request for Margaritas Wilson's grandchildren, Christian and Michaela, who are sitting right there in the middle, snap dab in the middle. They are going to be going to Florida for a month, so we want to make sure that they have safe journeys going to Florida, safe journeys coming back, and be safe while in Florida. That they enjoy themselves, but they remain safe, and we will certainly miss them because they're always a beautiful fixture to see out there with them here every Sunday. So have fun, but not too much fun. And we'll see you guys when you come back. Anybody else have a prayer request that they wanted to add in before we pray? Want to thank you so much for this day, for giving us a day that we can celebrate fathers around the world, those who are with us now and have very, very fond memories of the fathers who are not with us. And sometimes the person doesn't have to be a biological father to us. They could be a stepfather or father figure that really had some significant impact in our lives. We also want to pray for fathers who are struggling to have relationships with their children, that their relationships can be blessed and that they can be able to join in love and friendship and also guidance to the children and to have that connection and that relationship. So for those who might be estranged, we pray that they can come together and they can come together in love. We also want to thank you for the many praises that we send up today, for the blessings that were answered and the prayers that were answered that you have given us. We thank you for having people coming off our prayer list, and we thank you for your grace and mercy that you've given us. We also are happy to pray for anyone else who wants to be on our prayer list, because we know that the world needs prayer, and we want to keep praying for each and every person. We ask that you bless Jean Pizzetti as she's in the hospital. We ask that you bless Teresa as she's also struggling with asthma. And we also bless that you give traveling mercy and grace to Christian and Michaela as they travel to Florida, and that they're in Florida and be safe and return back to us as well. We thank you for this day that we can come together either in person or by YouTube so we can learn more about you and hear from Pastor John. We thank you for the traveling mercies that you've given Pastor John and Roberta to faithfully come and travel to be with us, to share the word, and to help guide us, and just to bless us with their presence and with their loving concern that they've shown to everyone. We thank you, Father God, for your love and your protection that you give to this church. We ask that you bless each and every one of us here and those who could not be here and those who are listening or watching by YouTube. We thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Our first hymn that we have will be God of Our Fathers, number 707.
Thank you. Lori.
Today's scripture reading will be in Psalms 103, verses 1 through 12. And if you're looking at your pew Bible, this is in page number 726 in your pew Bible. Again, we'll be reading Psalms 103, verses 1 through 12. And this particular psalm is subtitled as Praise for the Lord's Mercies. And it starts off by saying, Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is with me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies your mouth with good things, so that your mouth is renewed like the eagle's. The Lord execute righteousness and justice for all who are oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the children of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in mercy. He will not always strive with us, nor will he keep his anger forever. He has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor punished us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. And hopefully that will be a reading as a blessing on your heart as well, which I feel is a very beautiful verse. I hope you all felt it was beautiful as well, too. Our next hymn that we have is Faith of Our Fathers, hymn number 413, Faith of Our Fathers. I'll share just some brief memories about my father on Father's Day with you all. My father passed away back in 2015 around December 28th. And as Father's Day was coming up this week, I had a lot of memories come up about my father. And he used to cook a dinner for the entire family on Thursday nights back in Philadelphia. And it was I don't want to say the strangest thing, but it was the strangest thing because all of our cousins and aunts and uncles would come over, but then the young cousins would invite their friends to come over too. So we always had random people, and he would always cook dinner, and whoever came, came, and there was always food for them. But then my dad would always cook things that never really matched, they never really went together. So he would have spaghetti and rice. And you would say to him, well, why would you make spaghetti and rice? And he would say, well, Jason likes rice, so I made rice because Jason likes it. And every year for my birthday, whenever it fell around, on that Thursday, either before or after my birthday, he always made sure that he could have a splendid turkey or roasted chicken, but then he would always have liver and onions for me. And everybody would say, why would you make liver and onions? And he made that for me. And then he used to always have these weird sayings for advice, but really does make sense. Like when we were talking about dating, and he would always say to us, you keep your neighbors. And he would mean to say, you never date your neighbors. Never knew why he said that, but it always stuck with me. You keep your neighbors, and you never date your neighbors. So anybody that lives on either side of me, you're safe. Because I listened to my dad. But other things that he taught me is that I can finally remember him always going to church on Sunday because he was an usher. And regardless of what would be going on, he would put his suit on and he would always go to church to usher. And he always taught us that family was important. And we learned that every Thursday because he would always cook. And what we found out when he passed away was our uncles who are around his closer to his age and his brothers would always say that when he was younger too, before he had the family, he would cook like that for all of them because they all moved up from South Carolina. And when they all came here, he made sure he had dinner for them every Thursday night. I don't know why Thursday, such a random day, but it was on a Thursday night. So they were used to that, and that was the tradition that he would do it, and he carried it over even to the time that he passed away. So a lot of fond memories. So hopefully the fathers out there just know that people are paying attention to what you do and the little sayings that you say. And if nothing else, remember, keep your neighbors. Our special music will be the Lord's Prayer from Lori.
Forever. Amen.
Pastor John. Thank you, everyone.
Andrea, are we going to, we didn't sing the doxology yet. Shall we sing that?
Yes.
We sang it already.
We did not, I forgot.
Let's sing it right now. All right. Thanks. Glad to be with you this day. I'm enjoying greatly my own personal study in the book of Mark, and it's always my prayer preparation that I can convey some of that enjoyment and excitement to you, as well as the meaning of the passage and the application to our lives. Now that I'm wearing hearing aids, although I just took them out they still bother me a little bit. I'm not used to them. But because I'm wearing them, Roberta tells me that I talk too softly. Is that true today? Can you hear me okay? Am I too loud? Should I? Oh, no. Okay. All right. We'll leave it to the technicians to take care of the mic level, and I'll just keep going, okay? Our study in the book of Mark is moving along quite speedily, I think. And I realized as I was studying this week that we're just about at the end of his 3.5 years of ministry, the way Mark tells the story. Next week, we come to chapter, or next time that we study together, we'll be in chapter 11. And chapter 11 is Palm Sunday, as we generally call it. That's the week that Jesus enters the city of Jerusalem to begin his last week, the Passion Week. And that's a great story, and Mark gives it a lot of attention. Here we are a little bit more than halfway through the book, and he's going to the last week of his life. Just before he does that, Mark gives us a little bit of a sampling of what's coming. He talks to the disciples, and he tells them, you know, this next week is... these days ahead are going to hold a lot of really significant and important things for you. And in chapter 10, in verses 33 and 34, he summarizes or foretells what the week is going to look like. I want you to know ahead of time, the disciples really don't get this when he says that. He says what's going to happen. They don't understand what he's talking about. But this is what he says in verse 33, chapter 10. Behold, we are going to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man, that's the name that Mark uses here for Jesus, the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priest and to the scribes. And they will condemn him to death and deliver him to the Gentiles. And the Gentiles will mock him and scourge him and spit on him and kill him. I think that the Gentiles here is especially referring to the Romans and the Roman soldiers and so on, for they are the ones who largely did that. And on the third day, Jesus will rise again. So Jesus is telling the disciples what's coming, and the disciples can't grasp that idea in their minds and hearts. Why? Because Jesus is so popular at the moment. He's on a roll, we might say. Everybody is excited about his ministry, especially when he heals, especially when he makes some great provision and feeds 5,000 people. Everyone is talking about this miracle worker and so on, and anticipating this may be the Messiah. The kingdom is coming, and the Romans will be gotten rid of, finally, the hated Romans. And taxes will be reduced and will be a great life again, as it was in the days of King David and King Solomon. They don't understand that that day is coming, but it's not the day that's right in front of Jesus. The day coming for Jesus is the one he just described in detail here, the the author Mark described in detail when he said this is the time where they're going to condemn him to death and deliver him over to the Gentiles, and they will mock him and scourge him and spit on him and then kill him. That's what's coming. And we know from our study of the scriptures that it is a much later time, which hasn't occurred yet, when Jesus comes again, comes in glory. He comes to establish the reign of what the people were looking for here. That will be established someday, but not yet. So he's making his way south from Jericho to Jerusalem. Jericho is about 15 miles or so to the north and to the east of the city of Jerusalem. So Jericho and Jerusalem have a strong bond between them. It's not that far away. People can make the trip in a couple of 3 hours, perhaps, or 4 hours. And it's a common trade destination for items made in Jericho to be brought to Jerusalem for sale. And people living in Jericho were very commonly found in the city of Jerusalem for worship as well, because that's where the temple was located. It was the only place where, as a people, as a group of people gathered together, that the Jews worshiped. They had individual worship. They understood that worship is the heart pouring itself out to God. So they could worship in their home. They could worship alone in the countryside. A shepherd could worship in the fields while keeping watch over his sheep. And they did that, some of them. But when it came to corporate worship, gathering together, they couldn't do that. And as a result, unless they were in Jerusalem. As a result, there wasn't a lot of that going on. But now, Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem. And he comes across a beggar. We, once in a while, as we drive through Philadelphia, for example, on our way home, we'll see beggars here and there in Philadelphia. We know where they are at this point since we've made the trip, and they have certain street corners they like to stand on. Street corners where there is a red light from time to time that they can approach the cars that had to stop for the red light. If there's no reason for the cars to stop, it's not a good spot for a beggar. So one over by the Walt Whitman Bridge we go by, and another one over by the other bridge, the Ben Franklin Bridge, just before you get on. These are regular spots, and there are many others in the city as well. It turns out that the best spots for begging in Philadelphia are all spoken for. And spoken for means usually with some measure of force behind it. This is my corner, stay off of it. And sometimes it's a group of people that claim a corner, and they actually take turns on the corner so they never lose it. I don't know so much about that from firsthand experience, and I don't know anyone who actually was a beggar on a Philadelphia street corner to ask them, but I've read about it in newspaper exposés and so on, that sometimes there is something really shady going on in the background and somebody gets most of the money and so on. But I have read, and I easily believe it, that a good corner can bring in a lot of money. Hundreds of dollars a day if you're on the right street corner from begging. And I have no trouble believing that, because I have seen lots of people, when the red light comes and you stop there, drop money into the bucket as the guy goes from car to car. In Bible times, there was also such a thing as a good place to beg. And that good place was near to the temple, right in front of the temple, if you could get there first. And that's because people would have been in the temple and would have been bringing their own offering and sacrifice to the Lord. And they would have been reminded in many cases that part of the law required Jews to be generous with those who had little or nothing, to care for the poor, to care for widows and orphans, and to care for foreigners as well who face difficulties in living and so on, like we might call them street people, or what's the word I'm looking for? Homeless, yeah. Help those people, even if they're not Jewish, help them. It's your responsibility. So the closer you were to the temple, the fresher that would be in people's minds. And that was a good spot to beg. And there were other places too. Right at the city gate was a good place for us. People would come to Jerusalem for worship and head into the gate. They would see the temple. It monopolized the city. And as they would come through the city gates, they would be saying, oh, there's the temple. And now I can play my part as a good Jewish person who's religious and obedient to the law, and I can give some money to the poor. And the further away you were from the gate, the less desirable the begging spot was. And even more so if you had to sit outside the city on the road away from the gate. And that's where we find this beggar, by the way. Not in Jerusalem, but in Jericho, outside of the gate, outside of the city, along the road, begging. Not normally a good spot for a beggar, but this is not a normal day in the life of this beggar. Today is the day that Mark tells us he meets Jesus. Jesus and his disciples and a crowd that's following along with them leave the city of Jericho. Remember, about 15 miles to go. Leave the city of Jericho, headed towards Jerusalem. And as soon as they leave the city, just a short distance down the road, they run into a beggar whose name is Bartimaeus. It's an interesting name. Mark explains it to us in the text. That Bar is the word that means son of. And his name, we would say, was, the father's name was Timaeus. So son of Timaeus, Bartimaeus together, or Bartimaeus. And that's why he's called that. In fact, I want to read the text with you right now, okay, in Mark chapter 10, beginning in verse 46. Let's read this story first together. 46, I'll read it aloud. Read with your eyes with me. Now they came to Jericho. As Jesus, he went out of Jericho with his disciples and a great multitude. Blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the road begging. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. Then many warned him to be quiet, but he cried out all the more, Son of David, have mercy on me. So Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. Then they called to the blind man, saying to him, Be of good cheer, rise, for he, Jesus, is calling you. And throwing aside his garment, he rose and came to Jesus. The he there is Bartimaeus. Verse 51, so Jesus answered and said to him, What do you want me to do for you? And the blind man said to him, Rabboni, that I may receive my sight. It uses the word, and if you have a study Bible or some other note in your Bible, you'll see that that reference might be translated teacher or great teacher or honored teacher. Teacher, that I may receive my sight is what I want. Jesus said to him, Go your way. Your faith has made you well. And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus on the road. So Bartimaeus is begging for money, begging for alms as he sits by the side of the road. And he's a familiar sight to the citizens of Jericho. He's there every day. He's got the same place every day and is asking for money as always. And sometimes, evidently, some would give him something so he can eat and survive and come back another day. It seems like an ordinary day to people that see him sitting there, but it's not an ordinary day. It's a very special day, and God has special plans for Bartimaeus. At first, Bartimaeus is probably aware of something going on. Somewhere there's a ruckus, a noise, and he can't quite figure out what's happening. But eventually he learns that some celebrity has showed up in town, and gradually someone comes to tell Bartimaeus that that celebrity is none other than Jesus Christ. I think if we read the story carefully, it would seem that Bartimaeus has some background on who Jesus Christ is, because when he learns it's Jesus coming to town, he begins to cry out for him to help him. Have mercy on me. You wouldn't do that if you didn't know who the person was. You and I wouldn't immediately start crying out if somebody we didn't know walked through the back door. We would have to find out that, oh, a miracle worker just came into our church and is seated right next to the sickest person in the room. Maybe this is a good chance to ask him to work his miracle working power and heal this person. That seems to be the background that Bartimaeus had here. Jesus is the performer of miracles. He has healed the sick. He has given sight to the blind, and he's here, walking around the streets of the city of Jericho, headed out towards Jerusalem. And so he shouts again and again, "Have mercy on me, son of David." Even when the people around him denounce him, they do their best to make him keep quiet. I think they're embarrassed being in the presence or being even next to somebody who's calling out in this way, bringing embarrassment upon the whole community. And they quite emphatically urge him to stop with all the yelling. And I don't know why they were, I suggest jealousy, but maybe some other reasons too. Maybe they considered their own personal needs to be more worthy of Jesus' attention than Bartimaeus. That would be in keeping with human nature. Why are you bothering with him? I got my own problems. If you're going to heal somebody, how about me, right? Take care of my problems. It's possible as well that they don't like the suggestion that Bartimaeus is asking for help because they know he's asking for sight. Have mercy on me. What's his problem? Well, he's blind. He's not asking for a few extra alms. He's saying, mercy, mercy. And they know what he's asking for. And they're embarrassed that anyone would be asking for such an impossible gift. Are you kidding? You're embarrassing us all. Now just be quiet. And in the noise and distraction of that moment, Jesus hears this one voice coming from the midst of a whole slew of cries and outcries and voices and begging and cheering and singing, perhaps. He hears the request of this blind, poor beggar, and he stops and calls for him. The disciples are able to locate him. We don't have any idea what that involved, but they had to find the voice that Jesus was hearing and then bring the man to Jesus. Mark actually records the exact words of the disciples in verse 49. "Cheer up, on your feet," the NIV says. "He's calling for you." Cheer up. I have good news for you, the disciples are saying. Jesus is calling for. The disciples had never seen Jesus call for someone and not do some miracle in their lives. It didn't happen. So Jesus is calling for you. This is going to be something worth watching. This is going to be something good. Have you not found that in your own experience, when in some way God calls you, that there's something really wonderful connected with it? He calls you to a ministry that he has for you. There's going to be the amazing goodness that comes out of that somehow. Perhaps some of that in your own life, perhaps in the lives of other people. When God calls us to himself, there is always cheer connected to the story. Good news, because of the joy of Jesus actually knowing who I am. He knows our names. He knows, the Bible tells us, every detail of our lives, how many hairs are on our head, and the counting of that gets easier year by year, but he still knows. That's the amazing part of the story. He knows things about us that we don't even know ourselves and that no one else could possibly know. He knows because he knows everything. And he doesn't know it so he can flaunt it. It's not Jesus' point to prove to everyone that he's the smartest guy in the room. It's God's way of telling us in the Bible that he cares for us, and part of the care is possible. Part of the reason he cares for us as well as he does is because he knows everything about us. He knows the sorrow that's hidden in your heart that you have never been able to speak of to anyone else. God knows that. And he can care for you in ways that no one else could care for you because he knows us better than anyone else. I hope you have had the experience of having the joy and the cheer come to you because God has called you to himself. When Bartimaeus gets the call, he responds right away. Verse 50 says, throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. His cloak may have been his main possession in life. He probably sat on it if he was on the street side. He would have used it for warmth and so on. And he just forgets that. Nothing else matters at this moment. He has a chance to meet Jesus. And he is very, very hopeful. He throws the coat aside and comes to Jesus. By the way, that was your story. At some point in your life, if you're a believer, you heard a call from God, the call from the scriptures, perhaps. Perhaps you had an evangelist here at your church sometime, or perhaps it was Pastor Dave. His ministry was so important in the lives of so many of you. You heard God calling you to himself, and one of the things you did right away was drop everything else. The things of the world suddenly are not so important to us. The plans that we have for after church this afternoon, not so important to us. At this moment, God is calling me to himself, and that takes priority over everything else. That seems to be what's going on in Bartimaeus' life. The text doesn't tell us what the disciples thought of all this. The blind beggar asking for God's mercy and healing, they would have understood that, but what did they think about it? It doesn't tell us what the crowd thought. If there were any religious leaders, Jewish Pharisees and scribes standing by, and we read that they were there, we're not sure what they would have thought of this. We can guess at their thinking because we read so much in other places about the Pharisees, the scribes, and the disciples as well, and crowds of people. Who does this beggar think he is, asking for something as impossible as that? I can almost hear the Pharisees saying that. The nerve of this guy, what kind of request is that? And who does he think Jesus is that he would ask him for healing? Who does he think Jesus is? So probably other questions too, all casting spurious feelings on the blind man for what he's doing, how inappropriate it would be and so on. But Bartimaeus seems to know exactly what he's doing, and he knows apparently exactly who Jesus is. In verse 47, he calls Jesus the son of David. Now, David lived a thousand years before. Now, it doesn't mean literally the son of David, but in the family of David, a descendant of David. And therefore, one who has the right to the throne of David. He's in the family line of David. That was really an important part of this story of what it means to be the son of David. And it tells us that to Bartimaeus, Jewish history was something he knew something about, at least. He knew who David was, and he knew that the royal line was to be passed down through David. Somebody had explained to Bartimaeus in his lifetime somewhere something about the Old Testament prophecies regarding the Messiah, the descendant of David who would rule upon the throne someday. For example, in Jeremiah 23:5, we read these words, "For the time is coming, saith the Lord, when I will raise up a righteous descendant from the line of King David. He will be a king who rules with wisdom. He will do what is just and right throughout the land." But that hadn't happened yet. And it's a prophecy. One day, that's going to be the story. God's going to do it. I will do this. And it's quite possible that Bartimaeus had come into contact with this truth or this passage or other passages that say more or less the same sort of thing. There's no shortage of them in the Old Testament. Hundreds of verses that speak about the descendant of David who is promised to come and will sit upon the throne forever and ever. There's also teaching in the Bible that the Messiah coming would heal those who are blind and those who are sick and those who face other problems in life. And an example of that is in Isaiah's writing. Isaiah writes again and again. I looked up 22 verses in Isaiah that speak about the healing power of the one who is coming. When this son of David comes, when this descendant of David comes, he will have a healing power that David didn't have. David was not known as a healer. He was a king. He was a righteous king who led Israel into the ways of God in a great way. And he was a warrior and so on, but he wasn't a healer. And so this is something the Messiah is going to do that David didn't do. He will come and he will rule like David did, and he will fit into the line of royalty as David did, but he will do much more than David did. He will heal the nations, and he will heal the blind. And Bartimaeus seems to have some idea of this. Somebody taught him. I want to tell you, folks who have taught Sunday school, vacation Bible school, your own children or grandchildren at home or something along those lines, folks who have been part of that, this is a great blessing. You may not know what is going on in the mind of that child, but in some of their minds, some of that will stay. Some of it will find a home. We might say if it's like seed, it will find fertile ground. It will find a place to be planted and grow. And we can't see that going on. That's part of the beauty of the stories or the parables that Jesus tells about the crops that are growing. We can't see what's going on underground, the germination and the early growth and so on. But that has to happen for the plant to one day pop through the soil and to appear. And it may be your teaching that's part of the story of the germination, what's going on that we can't see. And one day it becomes visible. And that's not the time when we all start taking credit. Undoubtedly, because I was his second grade Sunday school teacher, he is now pastor of the greatest church in Los Angeles. We won't be able to say that, nor will we want to, as true believers. But imagine the thrill that will be yours just to think back on, boy, I remember when he was in my class in Sunday school. I had no idea God was going to get a hold of his heart the way he has and get a hold of his life the way he has. I had no idea that was going to happen. There's a guy in our church in Haddon Heights who's a missionary in South America. His first name is Al. He's a great guy. He was a kid when I was and Roberta were helping with the junior church back in our early days of marriage. And he was in the junior church. In fact, he was in a Sunday school class that I taught. And I remember him being in middle school when I was teaching that class one year. I actually never saw his face. I only saw his forehead and the top of his head, because this is how he sat all the time. And I thought, well, you've made your point clear. You're not interested in any of this. And I'm doing my best to make it interesting, and I'm doing my best to make it mean something to you. And I get it. I'm not doing a very good job on either one of those things. Then I lost track of him, and we went to Japan. And when we came home from Japan one time on a furlough, lo and behold, someone said, oh, Al and his wife, what's her first name? I can't hear you. Becky. Al and Becky are home, are getting ready to go to South America as missionaries. And you could have knocked me over, right? Are you kidding? Right? And again, I'm not saying, oh, I should have known he had me as a teacher. Far from that, right? What God did with that young man's heart is only known to God. It's unexplainable by human terms, right? But that's how God works. He does the impossible. With God, there is nothing that's impossible, because he does it as if it's possible. Things that we could never do or never understand. And that's how he worked in Al's life and continues to do so. So he's part of that story here with Bartimaeus as well. In fact, this story has a great ending. Jesus says, okay, you've called for me. You have asked for mercy. And he asked him, what would you like? And he said, I want to see. That's what I want. It seemed like a silly question in a way. He's a blind beggar, and he's calling for you to help him. What do you think he wants, right? It's not that Jesus was unaware of what he wanted. Jesus knew very well, but he wanted the crowd to understand what's going on here, right? He wanted the crowd to know this blind man has his priorities a little bit flip-flop. He wants sight. He's not asking for salvation. He's not asking for a relationship with God. He's not asking for sins forgiven. He just wants to see. And Jesus wants that to be part of the story of what he's going to do. So he said, if that's what you want, I give that to you. And in addition, I'm going to save you as well. He uses that in the verb he chooses to use. He uses the verb that's used for salvation. I'll give you sight, and at the same time, because of your faith, and his faith was that Jesus could do this. That was his faith. It was really a simple faith. None of us have to have a high theology faith to come to Jesus. You don't need to know every Bible doctrine to come to Jesus. What you need to know is the same kind of thing that Bartimaeus knew and believed. And he believed, and Jesus said, I see your faith, and you're healed, and you're saved. And Bartimaeus followed Jesus. That's how the text ends this section, right? Your faith has healed you, and Bartimaeus followed Jesus. I can hear Bartimaeus being asked about this experience by people later in the day. What was going on? What was it like to meet Jesus? And that sort of thing. And Bartimaeus may have had a very simple testimony. I'm sure it was much more simple than we would imagine. For example, he might have said, you know, I don't know the theology behind all this that went on today, but I do know this, that once I was blind and now I can see. We know that from another story in the Bible of another blind man, right? Once I was blind, but now I can see. That's what I know. There's a lot of other stuff in the story, but I'm not aware of it yet. I will become aware of it. I will find out. I will keep asking and getting stronger in my faith. But this is what I know now. I was blind, and now I see. You know, it would make a great song if anyone ever decides to write that, right? In a number of ways, Bartimaeus' story is mine and yours when it comes to our spiritual lives. Not to our physical problems, although it could be that. Jesus is still the one who, as the great physician, the one who heals. When someone is sick, someone has a great disease, we ask God to have his mercy upon him. We don't do so demanding God heal someone. That would be an inappropriate way for us to come to God. We trust God to do the right thing in that person's life, the best thing. He has plans for us, Jeremiah says, that are good plans. God, we trust you. We trust you so much that we're not going to tell you what your healing should look like. We just trust you to take care of it in your way and in your time. And so we pray and ask God. And sometimes God gives healing through a hospital or through a doctor or through a vaccination or a shot of some sort or through some kind of cream that you put on the sore, whatever it is. All different ways that God provides healing, but the provision is always from God. It's God who heals. Man can kind of be part of the mediation of that. We call them doctors. And a good doctor, the best doctor, is one who mediates and knows at the time of his mediation that it's God who heals and not the doctor, right? Don't worship me. Worship God. And I'm just the middle guy. And I think it's neat that so many of us are able to find Christian doctors who have that understanding and that attitude as they treat us. I've had the privilege of having doctors over the years who tell me and sometimes they demonstrate it before me, but they tell me when we brought you into the operation room and put you asleep for the open heart surgery, for example, I said to the staff, this man has spoken of his faith, and it would be appropriate for us just to stop and pray for him right now. So the whole operating, what do you call that, ensemble? Theater, operating theater, stops all the busy things they have to do in there, and they listen to the surgeon lead them in prayer. That doesn't happen every day. That takes a man who understands God is the great physician. I play a role in that story, but it's God who heals. And that's why we plead with God for healing. It's always appropriate for us to do that. I want to mention my sister Joy, whom you have been praying for. She has encephalitis at the moment and is facing serious issues with that. And I would say in the vernacular, she's not out of the woods yet, or she's still in hot water, or whatever it is. Her life is still, in some degree, hanging in the balance. And her family knows it, and they're praying, and many, many of us are praying for her. It's not inappropriate to pray for healing. That's what I'm praying for. Instead of saying to the Lord, oh, make her last days on earth comfortable, I still am asking God, have mercy on her. Son of David, have mercy on her, right? And God can do that. We don't know that he will, but he can, and that is the prayer of believers. Listen, our story is very similar to Bartimaeus, right? We too were blind to our sin and blind to the separation that sin brings. Even people who are aware of the evil that they sometimes do in their life, or that they think, or the evil that is found on their computers that they try to hide from others in the family, they're aware of all of that. But many times they're not at all aware that God knows this as well. And to God, this is evidence of a separation between this person and God himself. There's a divide there, a gap that no one can figure out how to get across on his own, because it's impossible for man to do that. And as Jesus came to town and heard the cry of Bartimaeus for mercy, so too does God hear your cry and my cry when we call out to him for his mercy. He's aware of that. In a noisy world, in a busy world, and God has lots going on, we could say he lives in a center of never-ceasing activity, he will hear the cry for mercy every time. If it's a cry of the non-believer for mercy, I guarantee you'll hear it. He's waiting to hear it. He's wanting to hear it. He has, the Bible says, delayed his return so that he can hear your cry and that you would repent of your sin and come to him. So as Jesus called Bartimaeus in our story, God is calling you and calling me. If we are believers, God still calls us. He calls us to service. He calls us to repentance. He calls us to purity of life. He calls us to various activities that he wants us to be part of. There's a place for you to minister. We had friends over for dinner a couple of nights ago. Isn't it nice to have our world returning somewhat to normal? They were our first company in a long, long time, apart from close family, somebody we could invite to the house. And they were telling us that Eric had a job with a government a company that has contracts for the government. His doctorate is in artificial intelligence with robotics, and he had his choice of jobs when he graduated from great colleges and UCLA graduate school and so on, and was making, in his own words, a pile of money, and thought this was the best thing ever, and began to think that there was, as a believer, growing stronger always in his faith, began to realize that he had put far too much hope in the money, and decided that really what God wanted him to do was to be involved in people's lives, much more so than in the business world or in robotics or whatever. And so he quit that job not so long ago, and now he works in Broad Street Ministries in Philadelphia, dishing out soup at lunchtime and helping people with their personal needs, and he gives a lot of consultation and encouragement through the week to homeless people and people who have been kicked out of their homes and are struggling to, you know, get back in and so on. He has heard the call of Jesus and has responded to it, and he has sprung to his feet, just like Bartimaeus, sprung to his feet to come to Jesus. I want to do that. Whatever you have for me, I want to do that, right? Some of you will say, oh, that was my story too. I remember that happening. I couldn't stay in my seat when God put it in my heart to teach at VBS. I had to do that. I had to do that. Or to go on a mission trip somewhere or something like that. And lastly, Bartimaeus' faith healed him. We see that in the text. He was healed because of his faith. So too, it's faith that in our own lives opens the floodgates of God's care and salvation to us. Without faith, it's not possible for any of that to happen. God sees faith in you and in me, and when he sees it, the response is the floodgates open wide, and the blessings pour down, and the goodness pours down, and salvation pours over us in every way you can imagine. And we become new creatures, new creations in Christ Jesus. And we become people who suddenly have a new reason to live. People who have a reason to get up in the morning other than drag myself to school or to work. I am a person with a mission, and my mission is to follow my Savior, follow Jesus Christ. So Bartimaeus' story has a lot to do with my story and your story. And if it doesn't, it could. That's the neat part about this. If this is not your story, it can be. For the Bible says that God is still calling people to himself today. He's still, through the pages of Scripture, calling you to put down your heavy burden and come to him. To stop trying to earn salvation in some way and come to him. To stop thinking that you're not such a bad person, you don't have a relationship problem with God, and get rid of that thinking and come to God. He's calling you to himself, and when he calls you, he is waiting with saving grace. He's going to open the floodgates of heaven and pour it upon you, and you'll be saved from beginning to end, from head to toe, from eternity to eternity. You will be a saved member of God's family. Nothing will ever be able to change that. It will be brought to perfect fruition when Jesus Christ comes again, and you are caught up into the sky to meet with him. And so shall you ever be with the Lord. It's your story. It's your story, and Bartimaeus reminds us of that. Listen, if it's not your story, make it your story before you leave this room this morning. Make it your story before you turn off your television home. Make sure it's your story. It's a great story. And Bartimaeus got up and followed Jesus. Amen? Thank you, Father, for this part of the word and for the lessons that come to us through the stories in the lifetime of Jesus and through the teaching that we find here in the book of Mark. Please give us a heart, give us all hearts for knowing more about Jesus and being able to follow Jesus, whatever it takes, wherever it whatever it costs. Please help us to be determined to follow Jesus if it's called for another place, to the ends of the world if needed, or just to follow Jesus in our neighborhood, but to live for Jesus in such a way that others are aware of something going on in our hearts, in our house. It's not the same person he used to be. Like Bartimaeus, he's a new person, a new creation in Christ Jesus. Help us, we pray, and to God be the glory forever and ever. Amen. We're going to sing together, aren't we? Take your songbooks, please, and open to Rise Up, O Men of God, 381. We're going to sing all the stanzas, 381. Yeah, Father, send us on our way, determined to live for you and to love you all the more, and to make the cry of mercy for others and mercy for us something that is part of our lives always. Give us the strength to live for you. Now may the grace of God, the fellowship of the Lord Jesus, and the guidance of the Holy Spirit be upon all your people. Amen.